Hello everyone, welcome back to Noteworthy ENT. We'll discuss about an important audiological investigation today, that is impedance audiometry. So this gives us a wide range of otological and neurological information about the nature and anatomical site of the lesion. So how is it useful? It objectively differentiates between conductive and sensorineural hearing loss. And one of the most important uses being, we can have a differential diagnosis in cases of conductive hearing loss. Also, we can measure the middle ear pressure and evaluate the eustachian tube function. And differential diagnosis of sensorineural hearing loss cases can also be done, whether the lesion is cochlear or retrocochlear. Some other uses are, it can also help us in identifying the site of lesion in facial palsy or other brainstem lesions. And we can also objectively have an idea about the hearing threshold. Also, malingering cases can also be ruled out through this test. So, these being the uses of impedance audiometry. And as I've already told, this is an objective and also a non-invasive test. It comprises of three basic tests, that is tympanometry, eustachian tube function test, and acoustic reflex tests. Now I'll be discussing about tympanometry in this lecture. The other two will be discussed in a separate lecture. So what is tympanometry? It is defined as the measurement of the changes of impedance of the middle ear at the plane of tympanic membrane as a result of changes in the pressure in the external auditory canal. So basically what we do is we change the pressure in the external auditory canal and we measure the changes of impedance of middle ear with relation to these changes. I'll come back to this. Let us first discuss the basic principle of tympanometry. So sound, if during its transmission it encounters a substance which is having different physical properties, then a fraction of sound will be reflected back from the surface of this obstructing material. And these properties are together known as impedance of the medium. So simply, if sound is traveling between two mediums, so depending on the physical properties of the medium, some of the sound will be transmitted and some will be reflected back. And these physical properties of the medium are known as impedance. Now, air has low impedance and cochlear fluid has high impedance. So in our auditory system, the sound waves travel from air to the cochlear fluid. So middle ear acts as an impedance matching device. How it helps is it prevents the loss of energy when the sound waves are traveling from air to cochlear fluid. So middle ear is the impedance matching device. So basically what we do is we change the pressure in the external auditory canal. And with these changes, we measure the changes in impedance of the middle ear. Now to measure, the measuring instruments have a probe which is held in an air-sealed cavity in the external auditory canal. And this probe, it has three apertures. Through one, we present the tone and the tone being 220 or 226 Hz. The second being the microphone amplifier assembly and the third is the air pump manometer system. We'll see in this diagram what are all these three things. So this is a probe which is fitted in the external auditory canal. Now this probe has three parts. One is through which the sound is transmitted inside. The other being the microphone amplifier assembly. This helps in picking up the reflected sound, and the third being the manometer system, which helps in changing the pressure in the external auditory canal. So what we do is we plot the impedance of the middle ear with relation to these changes. The pressure is depicted in millimeters of water on the x-axis and impedance depicted on the y-axis, and this being the tympanogram. However, it is easier to measure the admittance of the middle ear. Admittance means the exact opposite of impedance. So impedance basically means resistance to flow, and admittance being the exact opposite means ease with which the energy flows. So it is easier to measure admittance, and even easier is to measure the compliance of the middle ear. So this admittance is indirectly measured through compliance, and this compliance is ease of movement or springiness of the middle ear system, and this is easily measurable in milliliters. So most audiometers now measure compliance, and this is measured in milliliters. Now moving further, what is the procedure? As already discussed, this is a totally objective test. So as an objective test, the interpretation is more difficult than performing the test. This is in contrast to pure tone audiometry, where it is difficult to perform the test, but the interpretation is easier. So basically what we do is we place the probe in the external auditory canal, and we ensure it is a air sealed cavity, and it takes hardly 2 to 3 minutes to perform the test. Only a basic level of cooperation from the patient is required. We ask the patient not to swallow or breathe very hard during the test. Coming to the interpretation, we measure the compliance. So the normal range is believed to be in the range of 0.35 to 1.4 milliliters. However, this can be variable, and this is not a hard and fast range. Now coming to the variations in compliance. So the compliance can be normal, it can be increased, or it can be decreased. So increased compliance means that the springiness of the middle ear is increased. So it can be increased when there is ossicular chain discontinuity in cases of scarred or healed tympanic membrane. A scarred or healed tympanic membrane is usually thinner than the normal tympanic membrane. Also, in cases of very large tympanic membrane and in post-stapy surgery cases, the compliance is increased. So it can be decreased in all the cases where there is increased stiffness in the middle ear or there is some mass in the middle ear. For example, in otosclerosis, ossicular fixation, adhesive otitis media, or otitis media with effusion. Also in cases of thickened or tympanosclerotic patches on the tympanic membrane, and also when there is any mass or tumor in the middle ear. So any lesion which increases stiffness or there is some mass or fluid in the middle ear, it decreases compliance. And normal compliance, apart from normal cases, can be in eustachian tube obstruction without any significant secretory changes in the middle ear. So this was all about compliance. Now we'll discuss about the measurement of middle ear pressure. So it is expressed in terms of millimeters of water. Now the pressure at which the tympanogram shows the highest compliance is known as the pressure of air in the middle ear cavity. So basically, the pressure at which the middle ear is most efficient is known as the middle ear pressure. The pressure at which the middle ear is functioning most efficiently, that is the compliance is highest. The normal range is believed to be in the range of minus 50 to plus 50 millimeters of water. Some authorities, they consider minus 100 to plus 100 as the normal range. So the middle ear pressure can be decreased in cases of blocked eustachian tube, also in cases of otitis media with effusion, if the middle ear is not completely filled with the fluid. And the middle ear pressure can be normal in cases of otosclerosis, ossicular chain fixation, discontinuity, or if there are any scarred or thickened tympanic membrane changes. Now, absence of pressure peak, it is seen in cases when there is no significant middle ear space left. So, in cases of adhesive otitis media, when the tympanic membrane is completely plastered on the promontory, or in cases of otitis media with effusion, when the effusion is completely filling the middle ear. Also, in cases of tympanic membrane perforation, or there is a patent grommet or a ventilatory tube. Also, when the canal is completely filled by cerumen or wax. So, these are the middle ear pressure changes we can have in pathologies of the ear. Now, positive pressure peaks are very uncommon. However, if encountered, it can be there in early acute otitis media, or also in cases if the patient has swallowed, cried, or performed Valsalva during the test. So we have to ensure that this has not happened, and if doubtful, we have to repeat the test. Now, combining the compliance and the middle ear pressure, there are some shapes of the tympanogram described. They were first described by Jurger in three basic curves, which are A, B, and C. A being when there is a relatively sharp maximum compliance at a normal pressure, and B when there is no clear-cut peak seen, that is, it is a flat tympanogram. Now, this flat tympanogram can be seen in otitis media with effusion, adhesive otitis media, or perforation of the tympanic membrane. So, basically, all the cases when there was no clear-cut pressure changes. And C being when there is normal compliance but negative middle ear pressure. As discussed, they were seen in eustachian tube blockage or early otitis media with effusion. Now, this type A curve is subdivided into AS and AD. AS meaning normal middle ear pressure with a low compliance, that is seen in ossicular fixation, otosclerosis, and thickened tympanic membrane. And AD meaning that the pressure is normal but the compliance is high. It can be seen in ossicular discontinuity and in cases of scarred or a healed tympanic membrane. So we'll see all these in this picture. Now, this being the tympanogram, air pressure is depicted on the x-axis in millimeters of water, compliance in milliliters on y-axis. Now, the range of normal compliance is usually between 0.3 to 1.4, and the air pressure is usually between minus 50 to plus 50. However, in this case, it is depicted as minus 100 to plus 50. So, this being the normal compliance and pressure area. Now, this type A curve is when we are having normal compliance and normal middle ear pressure. This is seen in normal people. And if the pressure is normal but the compliance is decreased, in this case, this is known as AS type of curve. And this is seen in fixation of the ossicular system. It can be seen in ossicular fixation or otosclerosis. And similarly, with the pressure being normal and the compliance is high, this is known as AD type of curve, typically seen in ossicular discontinuity. And if we see this P peak, that is compliance being normal in the negative pressure range. It is seen in Eustachian tube obstruction, and this is known as type C curve. And if there is no clear-cut peak seen, that is, there is no clear peak pressure, this is known as a type B curve, and it is seen in otitis media with effusion, perforation, or in cases of adhesive otitis media. So this completes the tympanometry part. I'll be making a separate video on Eustachian tube function tests and also acoustic reflex test. If you found this video helpful, please support the channel by liking the video and subscribing. Thank you.